But first, a special investigation by NITV has revealed how thousands of Aboriginal children were given criminal records for being a part of the Stolen Generation. The report shows how it was systemic until the late 80s for these children, some as young as one, to get a police record just for being a child in need of protection. It all came to light when Larry Walsh discovered he had been branded a criminal at only two. Hashela Kamara-Wanza reports.
It was the question Larry Walsh had been asking for decades.
How could I have got a criminal conviction at the age of 2.5?
For years, he says the authorities used a criminal record he knew nothing about against him. The mystery consumed the Tongarong man until he applied for his criminal record, and what he found has left him with more questions than answers. The first charge listed, his removal from his family when he was only 2.5 years old. His stated offence was having needed a care and protection application while his sentence was being committed to the care of child welfare services. His removal from home was also listed as a conviction on a Victorian police criminal history sheet, leading to a life of tainted reputation.
Someone reckoned I'd end up in jail for murder. Someone reckoned I'd end up in jail for armed robbery. That's what the view was of Aboriginal people with criminal records.
His story triggered an investigation that found it was standard procedure for children to get a police record for being taken until the late 80s. Documents published by the Victorian Children's Court highlighted a systematic failure to distinguish between children who needed protection and young offenders. This system deemed babies, children and young people in need of state protection to be criminals, with this appearing on their police criminal histories. Bronwyn Naylor, a law professor at RMIT University, conducted part of the research.
Until the late 1980s, the Children's Court managed both child protection matters, which is welfare matters, and also criminal matters. So the orders that they made appeared on the same document. So there was a real blurring of the powers of the court.
She says this early police record could have caused many to be punished for crimes they never committed.
So this was a real surprise that there was that blurring or that combination of protection matters and criminal matters. And we really feel that this has significant consequences for people, literally in terms of what their criminal record looks like, but also in terms of how they feel themselves.
Larry Walsh is adamant that having a police record from such a young age has adversely affected his life. His first memory of being accused of criminality was when he was just 8 years old.
I spent most of my childhood and half to three quarters of my teens in a system that refused to recognise me as a person.
He says his discovery has raised questions for an entire generation and is calling on others who are removed to contact their local Aboriginal legal service.
It's got to change, it's got to stop, it's got to be admitted. And it's got to be expunged.
In 2014, Victoria became the first state to erase the criminal records of men convicted of having gay sex. The move ended decades of anxiety for countless men who are prosecuted for homosexuality. Andrew Jackamos says it's not too late for the government to grant the Indigenous community this same justice.
I would like to think that the government, with the evidence it already has and the advocacy that they should receive, that they should consider expunging the records of children who've got criminal histories for being children in care.
Unlike in other states and territories, Victoria allows old or irrelevant records to be released. This means that for people like Larry Walsh, the anxiety of being treated like a criminal will continue to follow them.
They had to live with thinking, why is the universe against them? Because they don't even know that they've got a criminal conviction. Someone needs to admit wrongdoing was done.
While the research was conducted in Victoria, many case studies from across the nation have come to light, suggesting this systematic failure is more widespread. With the issue now raised, Larry Walsh has found some answers. But can this rectify the damage done from the injustices of the past?
I'm joined now in the studio by the journalist who broke the story, Sylvia Rowley, and in Melbourne by Associate Director at the Centre for Innovative Justice, Stan Winford. Welcome to you both. I'll start with you first, Sylvia. How did you hear about this story?
I was doing some work for a small Indigenous organisation in Melbourne called Wardungan, and I was interviewing Aboriginal people who had faced discrimination because of old or irrelevant criminal records. And Uncle Larry came in, and when I was interviewing him, one of the things he mentioned was that police and magistrates had kept referring back to this record that he supposedly had from 1956 when he was 2 years old. And that just didn't make any sense.
Of course.
So Wardungan helped him to apply for his full police record. And when he got it back, sure enough, there it was. You know, the very first entry in that record from 1956 was his care and protection application, and it was listed as an offence.
Yeah, it would have been pretty hard to believe to see that for the first time.
Yeah,
Stan, I'll bring you in here. The impact of this record on his life, both personally and in a legal sense, how would you sum that up?
Oh, look, it's had a massive impact on Uncle Larry's life. It's affected him in many, many ways. It's affected how he feels about himself. I mean, legally, having a criminal record is a symbolic recognition or a symbolic stigma that you are a criminal, you are a convict, you have a conviction. So personally and practically, it makes an enormous difference to how people are treated and how they experience their interactions with police and with courts and all that sort of stuff. And Uncle Larry's story demonstrates that really clearly.
And obviously it's had an impact for a lot of the formative and early years. What about into the future? Do you think it'll still have an impact?
I think that, you know, until somebody admits wrongdoing in this situation and until there's some attempt to make amends for what's happened, I think that it will continue to be something that plays on Uncle Larry's mind and that is a source of anxiety and also a stain on his record that hasn't been cleared.
Mm. And Stan, you've been dealing with Larry's case, obviously, and other cases within Victoria. But what about instances of this elsewhere, you know, the giving of criminal records like this? Is it only limited to Victoria?
No, look, we believe that it's a widespread practice across Australia. And it seems as though across Australia, most jurisdictions treated criminal records and care and protection matters for young people as pretty much the same thing. So when a child was taken into care, an application was made to have them made wards of the state, those records were treated as criminal records and they show as criminal records. And there are reports about the stolen generations, there's the forgotten Australians, and all of them have stories of people who have been affected by this.
We saw in the story leading into this about records being expunged in this case. Stan, do you think that would be the answer or solution in this case?
Well, I think something has to be done. There's a clear precedent there, something that should never be on someone's criminal history can be removed, and the Victorian government has done that from 2014. There is absolutely no reason why that couldn't happen here. And I think, in fact, it's quite critical that it occurs because we can see how it's affected people like Uncle Larry, and that injustice must be addressed, and I don't see why we should be waiting. People like Uncle Larry have carried this around with them for most of their lives, and finally the time's come to do something about it.
Sylvia, I'll come back to you here. You've seen it in person, I guess, with Larry. Would that be enough, you think, to fix those, you know, those years of trauma?
Well, I think firstly more research needs to be done to find out actually what the impact of this has been on, you know, thousands of other people's lives. We've seen how much it's affected Uncle Larry's life, and it's really sort of set up the course of his life in many ways, and is still a source of anxiety. So I think we can't really say until we know the full extent of what's happened.
And I think just lastly, anyone that is in a situation similar to Larry's, what advice would you have for them? I'll start with you, Sylvia.
I think that they could contact their local Aboriginal legal service. If they're based in Victoria, they can also contact an organisation called Connecting Home, and you know, try to get hold of their full police record, see what's on there, perhaps apply for their wardship file as well, because that also contains a lot of information.
Stan, would that be the same advice from you as well?
Absolutely. And the only other thing I'd suggest is that if people in situations like Uncle Larry's want to take this further, that the Wurdungan Criminal Record Discrimination Project is very interested to hear from people with that experience, because we think these stories and the story that's been told tonight really need to be heard, and people who have the power to do something to address this need to hear them. And we know that there must be many more people like out there like Uncle Larry, and we're keen to hear about those stories.
Sylvia, have you heard any other instances similar to Larry's?
Well, I've spoken to Vicky Roach, who's a well-known campaigner in New South Wales, and she had a very similar situation, and that was in New South Wales, so it suggests that there's a whole swathe of people there as well.
There could be more to come.
Yeah.
Sylvia, Stan, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.